Hi, welcome back to The Shtick, where we're still on Zoom to Sydney with one of the most congenial, exciting and highly topical personalities that I know. His name is Henry Weinreich.
Indeed. Oh, it's an honour always to be interviewed by you, Henry Greener, and the tradition that you hold with Jewish and Israel broadcasting, especially with the situation that we're experiencing right now, is gold.
Can you believe it's almost 6 months?
I can't believe it. Believe it. And I don't think Jewish people and people in Israel can believe it either.
No, I know. And it's just ongoing. We wanted to talk about that a little bit later. But now I want to talk about you as the author of a book that's just about to be published. It's Stories My Father Told Me.
Stories I Told My Son.
I Told My Son, I know.
Yes,
well,
me.
Who told me? And your father, his name was Joseph Weinreich. He was a Holocaust survivor. What year did he arrive in Sydney?
He arrived in Sydney in 1949, when the tallest building in Sydney was David Jones, four stories high.
Really?
Literally. Yes. Yeah. With all the stories that he brought with him, and Australia helped him slowly melt away the trauma.
So just a little bit more about the book and the stories.
Well, you know, in my life, I've had, as everybody does, a varied career and experience. Mine happened to be in wedding gowns that took me to America 15 years. I then progressed to my own TV show called Style Court that was right across the country. And actually, the show was syndicated and was shown in Israel and South Africa and United Kingdom. Then I came back to Australia, more bridal gowns, and that progressed to much more TV in Australia, which included Project Runway Australia. And people still come up to me and ask me in fashion. But I have to say, one of the most challenging and honourable professions that I've morphed myself into is being an author, because it holds the legacy of our family and the Jewish people. So it's based in the Holocaust, but also in Sydney, Australia in 2024.
That's fantastic. Well, you just told me you wrote the last line of the narrative, which means the book is now ready to be published.
Yeah, so basically, you know, the book was taken through its paces. So that means I have had famous playwrights read it. I've had famous authors in England read it. And the main feedback was, for a Holocaust story to really make impact, you've got to intertwine it with your own intergenerational impact from your father. So I've now completed my narrative, and now it's going to be thread through. And we've already approached some major publishing houses, of which three have read the first three chapters. And now, when we're ready, they want to read the whole thing. So based in England, which I'm proud of.
Wonderful. Well, I just want to also talk to you about your advocacy, which I think is very important at the moment. I just spoke to Lindsay in the last segment, and now you are also a Sydney sider, and you've got a lot to say about the reaction of your community to what is going on.
Yes, I mean, it's very interesting, because I realised the other day that in actual fact, the Holocaust has intergenerational trauma and impact. But interestingly enough, what the Jewish people are experiencing right now, whether they're in Israel or outside Israel, is intergenerational trauma. Because what happened was, it went to the raw nerve of what Jewish people are all about since the Holocaust. And that's why the book, which is focusing on intergenerational trauma, especially from the perspective of 2024, is very, very current. And the one thing that I've really come to realize, and I was one of those persons, I don't know if you were, is I really hit the wall, and I really hit a black hole. I sunk. You know, all the anti-Semitism, the existence of Israel, you know, genocide from the International Court of Justice. What are we? What aren't we? You know, we're colonizers. We are bombing people and murdering babies, you know, we're apartheid, what aren't we? And so I think it's really important to acknowledge that sometimes a lot of us go into a quagmire. You get very depressed. You don't want to go out. You're scared. You've lost friends. And I recognize that syndrome with me. Have you been through that?
Absolutely. Not so much. Yeah. Considering I do weekly Jewish television, I get very minimal feedback from the show. But on Facebook, which is my main platform, I have people who I've lost because they keep repeating the narrative. And that's what I saw in Sydney University this week. There was a protest there, and they were just screaming colonialist, genocidal, massacres. Yes. You know, they're using the same words, and I consider it's a virus.
Well, you know, I it's interesting because I went to a recent speech and event with Douglas Murray, who's a famous political analyst. He's very pro-Israel. I had front seats. He also analyzes the situation in Israel, the situation in Gaza, and he made a really interesting comment, and that was, you give me a better idea of what Israel could do when you've got Iran and all the other terrorists that want to obliterate the Jewish people, and I'll listen. So I think what we've got to acknowledge is the Jewish people and Israel and people all around the world that support us can enter into a black hole because it starts to unravel you. It starts to make you think, you know, really, your existence and Israel's right to exist and you as a Jewish person. So there was something that I decided to break myself free from that black hole. You know, when you look at Facebook and when you go and see those, you know, protests, it's you have to have a mindset. Because if you don't have a mindset, you won't go out. It can get very depressed. It can get clinical. So I'll tell you what my breaking point was and how I got out of it. I didn't want to go to any rallies. I didn't want to leave home. I lost friends. And I thought, you know what? I'm going to go to a rally, which never again is now, and it was a non-denominational rally. And I was very low. I'm like, oh, this is, like, how can you even, you know, it's going to have music. How are they going to have music? I feel so depressed. It was extraordinary. There were 10,000 people, and I was right in the front, and I looked behind me, and you know what I saw? 10,000 diamonds. And I thought to myself, from now on, I am going to surround myself with diamonds. I'm going to surround myself. Would you like to know how I've done it more?
Yeah, you can tell us a little bit more.
Okay. So I think, how do you do it? Because it's very easy to say, oh, it's so easy. There's so much you can get involved with. First of all, block out the social media that is depressing you. If anyone's coming onto your social media pages, block them. Number one, essential. Number two, get yourself like this. You are. IA has amazing guest speakers. I'm going, for example, to locally. There are people that are starting to do interviews and they're doing events. I'm going to Linda Ben Menashe. She just went to America and Israel. And Douglas Murray. So when you say special guest star, look in the Australian media, check onto Shtick, get involved. And I tell you what, is there's two reasons why, and it gets you out of the black hole. Number one, you get more information about how to compete, you know, how to block the anti-Semitism and Israel's right to exist and why Israel has the right to defend itself in the way it has. And number two is the magic of being around people that support each other. I mean, and make friends with them. Make friends with them.
So I just wanted to mention that you're planning to go to Israel. Tell me about the kitchen shtick. June the 15th, you're going to Israel.
Okay, so I think the thing is, this is the opportunity, and not just the opportunity, but it's also Israel needs us. You know, I went to a lecture in UIA, and her name was Michal, and, you know, she's responsible for all the communities next to the border of Gaza. And she said to me, look, we have never come to Australia or anywhere else in the world as Israelis, because, you know, Israelis are very strong, and said, we need you. And I'm telling you now, she said, we need you. So it really struck me. And I thought, you know what? I can say I support Israel. I can love Jewish people, but you need to roll your sleeves up. So I'm really excited, although it's going to be very somber. I booked my own trip to Israel at the end of June. I booked my Airbnb. And anyone that's watching this program, you think, okay, you get there. What are you going to do? How do you volunteer? It's unbelievable. Just Google volunteer groups Israel. And you know what the problem is, Henry? Too many. Too many. There's like, Iron of Swords, and you've got Israel transport, Jews who are volunteering without transport, and Leket who pick you up in the Bindle of Habima at 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning, and they schlep you over to the farms, and you pick fruit, and you go into displaced Israelis. You can go to Hostage Square, and it's incredible. But the one organization that I have to recommend that I connected to after October 7 is a group called Citizens Kitchen. Have you heard of them?
Yes, I have.
You have. You know, they're getting such a reputation. Here's what's interesting. It's really David and Goliath. They're a small organization. They started to have their, their charity, well, their business, sorry, was a culinary school. October came out. They started October 8th. They changed the whole operation. And they now are actually called Citizens Kitchen. And they create meals, 500-600 meals a day. They go to army. They go to displaced people. And if you go on to Instagram, citizens_kitchen, and you go on, you can go to, so every week when I get down, this was the other thing, and you go, oh my God, this is just hopeless. I don't know what to do. You go onto the GoFundMe, you donate $118 for high, and you feel like you've done something, and it supports them. Now, the thing I love about that group is there's no administrative costs. It goes straight to the source. And they have Olim Hadashim there. They have people that are displaced. They do dating nights. I love them. So what I again advise anyone that's in a big dark hole is research, find an organization that's based in Israel that is a small organization. I mean, you've got UIA here and you've got Janet, and that's also good to support. But for those people that are also feeling they want more personal connection, start with Citizens Kitchen. And as you know, Henry, everybody's recommending them. Everybody. So, and that has uplifted me. And then they email back with, what's happening in Tel Aviv and how, they're doing women's groups on how to be an entrepreneur during the war. It's incredible. But I think if you're thinking about going to Israel, there's so much support, and I've been told that the volunteers are really, that they are embraced. And, you're also pumping money into the Israeli economy. It's down 20%.
Yep.
I think it's essential. I think and you know what, Henry, you've always got time if you want to, and you've never got time if you don't want to.
That's right. Well, we've got to find the time and the energy and the money to support Israel. Henry, it's a really great pleasure to have you on the Shtick. I've been trying for a while, and unfortunately your father passed away.
Yes.
And you were still mourning, you were still in heavy mourning, and now you're at that point where you can start coming out and doing your media.
Yeah, well, it's interesting, Henry, because my father's with us, and he loves Shabbat. So I know he's having perpetual Shabbat up there, perpetual Shabbat. He's selling it. He's already made a million friends, souls. But I tell you what I've realized. The connection with my father through the stories I told my son will be a connection that will be passed on right around the world, because it's going to be a really top memoir. And so he's with me, he's with us, and we have to remember the Holocaust was not that far, it's not that been that many years, and now it's returned, and we have to be strong. The best thing you can do is connect with like-minded diners, Jewish, not Jewish, and reject and block anything that gives you angst, anything that makes you worried, anything that wants you to bring out hate in your heart. Because as my father told me, hate will not win.
That's right. We've got to defeat the haters. Henry, we have to go now, and thank you so much. We'll be in touch. It's been too long. When you come to Melbourne, we'll have to go out again and have dinner.
It's an honour to be on your show, and really, you've always been a torch in the Jewish community and the Israeli community, and now more than ever, you're a meteor. Thank you so much for the work you do.
We'll be back after the break with Rabbi Gersh Lazaro, who's established a new shtick called the Shtiebel. So we'll find out all about his Shtiebel after the break. See you then. Thanks, Henry.